Hi, I'm State Representative Bruce Ayers. And as a state representative, I realize how important it is to keep my constituents informed of matters going on at the State House. I want to welcome you to my legislative update. You know, currently at the State House, we're debating over Governor Charlie Baker's $37 billion budget for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And like with any budget, we focus in on our priorities. And one of the priorities for my district are senior citizen issues. And to help us with today's show, my guest is the Chairwoman of Elder Affairs, Denise Garlick. Denise, thank you for coming.
It's my pleasure, Bruce.
You know, one of the things that I think is great about the House of Representatives is we all come from different backgrounds. And I was wondering before we start off if you could talk a little bit about how you got involved with public service. I knew you were a selectman from Needham before. And maybe tell the viewers a little bit about yourself.
So I'm always very pleased to tell people that I've been a representative. I'm in my sixth year. But I have been a nurse, a registered nurse, since 1975. And I have done acute care nursing at one of the major Boston teaching hospitals. But I also cared for individuals with developmental disabilities. I worked at a psychiatric hospital in the Commonwealth. And I also worked with a healthy college population. So I feel like I've had a chance as a nurse to see people at different stages of their life, different circumstances, healthy and acutely ill. And I think of all those experiences when I'm serving in the legislature.
Well, it's a big help. You know, we serve with a lot of diverse communities throughout there, and to have someone with your background and your experiences, how do you incorporate that role into being Chairwoman of the House of Representatives Elder Affairs Committee?
So I think being a nurse has helped me think about the circumstances that older adults go through. But I think that opportunity of having been a nurse and those different experiences is like your experiences, Bruce, where you've been a small businessman, where you've dealt with people with disabilities. I think that those experiences strengthen the legislature. You know, it's not, I'm always trying to help people to understand that we don't only think about legislation, you know, all the budget work we do, all the constituent work we do, but our strength for you and I think, is that we bring unique perspectives, unique circumstances. And that's what the people of the Commonwealth want most of all, people who truly represent them.
Yes, it's true. And I know the Speaker puts a lot of emphasis in your legislation, particularly now. And, you know, I think it's important to have that type of background and experience. You know, when you're talking with some of the colleagues that we have to work with to kind of woo some of the votes that we need to pass these laws. You know, we have a lot of attorneys, we have a lot of businessmen, but uniquely to have a nurse in your position, I think is a key role. You know, as chairwoman of the committee, how do you interact with the Senate committee? Can you talk a little bit maybe about the differences in the House and the Senate branches and your relationship with the Senate chair?
So folks may know that we have joint committees. So, and that joint means both the House of Representatives and the Senate working together. I believe that I co-chair this committee with Senator Pat Jalin, who for years has worked on the issues of elder affairs. And so we have the same motivation and the same perspective. But there's a different way that the Senate and the House may approach issues, and each of them have their own strengths. And when we're working together, whether it's with the Senate or it's in caucuses of representatives as we go forward, the House of Representatives is much more pragmatic. We deal with the money issues. We're trying to think about infrastructure. As we do that within our own House, I actually want to talk about the whole idea of caucuses. And I think people want to know that unlike Washington, in Massachusetts, we work well together.
Yes.
We work well with the Senate, but we work well within our own House of Representatives as well. And I am particularly grateful, Bruce, for your work leading the caucus, which is a group of representatives that come together, that today agree on an issue, mm-hmm. and tomorrow on a different issue, it might be a whole different group of representatives. But you are leading the group of representatives on the issues related to seniors. And it's a wonderful group of people, completely bipartisan, trying to pull in the same direction. And I think that's the kind of work we do best, when whether it's within our own house or it's with the Senate, that we decide which direction we're pulling and we work together.
Yes, absolutely. You know, I know one of the pieces of legislation that is currently before the Elder Affairs Committee is the Mass Home Care Program that establishes the registry for home care workers. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you could share with some of the viewers how that program or that legislation would work.
So that's a really big issue right now. And one of the things I've had the opportunity to do as the chairwoman is to travel around the Commonwealth. And I think when we think about our seniors, we're talking about a whole new group of people. We have our World War II generation seniors. We have the silent generation seniors that were born like before 1945. And now we have the baby boomers. And these three different groups have different needs. They have different values. And they have different ideas about how they want to move into the future. So when we're talking about the home care registry, one of the things is we're finding more and more seniors who want to live at home and in their own community for as long as possible.
Sure.
So to be independent doesn't mean that you don't need help. Mm-hmm. So to be independent in your home, you might need help, and that's going to bring us to home care. One of the things that I'm really concerned about is that the idea of a registry. So if somebody is coming into your home, I think you should know who that is. You should know that there's been a safety check on them. You should know if they're prepared to do CPR, if they're prepared for other skills. And you should know that that's visible to you and to anyone who loves you who's concerned about that. That's the idea of the registry. But around home care, we want to be sure that we have qualified people coming into homes caring for seniors, and we want to be sure that the home care agencies, we understand how they are functioning too. Right now in the Commonwealth, it's pretty easy to set up a home care agency. It's pretty hard to do a really good job. We're going to balance that out, I hope.
Great, great. Well, you know, I know one issue, and you alluded to it too, that I hear from the seniors in my district, like you say, is staying at home. Staying in their environment, whether it's with their family, and it's important that they know there are resources out there. In my district, we have the South Shore Elder Services, the Quincy Elder Services, the Randolph Elder Services, but there's so many programs that they offer, like you say, with home care, Meals on Wheels, transportation. Recently, the delegation did a segment on the circuit breaker. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we got an awful lot of response after the show from some of the seniors that didn't realize that that program was out there and there was money to be saved. You mm-hmm. know, I had spoke with one woman who, her husband had passed away, and he used to do all the books, the taxes. And now she was faced with it, and we all know tax time is a stressful time. Mm-hmm. It can be a daunting task, but when she inquired about the senior circuit breaker, she realized there was people that could help her with money management, and she actually got some money back. So with some small changes, it really took all the stress out of her situation. Mm.
And I think for you to do that program here is incredibly helpful. What I know is true is the Commonwealth actually spends $3.5 billion on our seniors. But much of that money is for the most poor and the most frail. And then I imagine there's a few people who are so wealthy they'll never have to worry about their resources. But in the middle are a lot of people, representative, that are putting their head on their pillow at night and they're worried about how they're going to get through. And there are resources if we could let more people know about that. And it's something that on our committee that we're thinking about a lot. How do we address those issues for those people in the middle and make sure we give them help?
Absolutely. You know, I know during the last legislative session, one of the issues that was very important to you was the bill you sponsored. It was actually landmark legislation protecting patient safety. Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
So I can elaborate on that, but not before I say thank you. Thank you for your support on that issue. Thank you for years of support on that issue. So that issue is around safe staffing. And it in the nation, it was the first law in the nation around having safe staffing in intensive care units. And we were able to get that one piece. There's more work to do. But it says that an intensive care unit nurse, and the people who are watching this show understand this and know this, there's a limit to how many intensive care unit patients you can care for. The law now says no more than two. And in fact, to even get assigned two intensive care unit patients to a nurse, it has to be a decision between that direct care nurse and the management. It has to be a conversation and a decision if that's possible. But in no other state in the country is this in law. California does it in regulation, but in Massachusetts we do it by law. So thank you for years of support on that.
Well, thank you very much for your leadership on that. And I know another issue that was important to you was the safe lifting.
Yes.
And maybe you could discuss that legislation and how that kind of is playing out.
So that's legislation that's pending right now. And I think that's an issue that is common sense, and we get that. You know, nurses do a lot of lifting. You know, nurses have a lot of back problems and shoulder problems. And we need to keep our nurses doing direct care. We want them not to be injured. The safe lifting is a way just to say to facilities, you have to provide a program and you have to provide some equipment. And you have a choice on whether how you're going to set this up, but you have to be sure that there is assistance to lift people. And I think it's something that the public understands. It's something we want hospital administrations to appreciate.
Sure, sure. It's putting off a lot on the nurses to get injured in something like that. You know, as chairwoman, what are some of your most, during your tenure, what are some of the things you're most proud of that you've worked on legislatively?
So for our Elder Affairs Committee, I think one of the things that I want to share is this traveling around the Commonwealth and that sense of what it is that our seniors are thinking about and learning a lot. You know, I have learned every community that I travel to has its own personality and its own culture. I went to the town of Franklin, and the senior there wanted to talk about substance abuse and seniors. Mm-hmm. Very, very important issue that we don't hear a whole lot of talk about in the press, but we did get into legislation that for all of the work that we're going to do around substance abuse, that we remember to look at our seniors and make sure they have resources and education and information, and they also can be strengthened through our work on substance abuse. I went to the town of Stoughton, and those seniors are talking about transportation and how hard it is, particularly for seniors in suburban areas, to get anywhere once they are no longer driving. And to stay independent, how are they going to do that, and how are we going to help them with that? You know, I was out in Springfield, and those seniors are very concerned about nutrition issues. And interesting enough, in a big city, don't have a lot of supermarkets. Mm-hmm. So they can't get good food and fresh food. And I know here in Quincy, you've got, you'll have to remind me, how many seniors are you trying to keep track of here in Quincy? I think it's, is it 18,000?
Yeah, we've got a big senior population. And as, you know, we work together on legislation, we know that the senior population is growing and growing. So to advocate with you and the members of the committee to try to get as much money as possible for our seniors in the budget, I know is one of the key roles. You know, and we're getting some substantial funding for the city of Quincy, for the town of Randolph, and I mean these programs make just a big difference, I think, in the quality of life to our seniors. And as you alluded to, the seniors want financial security, financial independence. And I was talking with one senior in the district, and she was so set in her old financial portfolio she kind of was a creature of habit. She didn't want to change the rules. But after she met with someone down the local senior center and came up with just a few small changes, she ended up selling her car because she never really used it in the first place, mm-hmm. took that money and put it towards other areas where she needed it, and started the transportation service. And it's been a complete 360 for her.
Oh, that's great.
You know,
that's
so great. With the Council on Aging, you know, with some counseling, and you know, I think the main point for seniors is to know that there's information and resources out there to help them.
Right, and I think that those kind of decisions, we want to be very mindful about where seniors are getting their information. That your constituent would go to the senior center, incredibly important. We know that one of the places we've seen a bump in the governor's projected budget is in protected services, mm-hmm. and that's about, in some part, about all these financial scams and the phone calls, and
yes.
now we're hearing about people are getting emails that look like it comes from the IRS asking for identifying information.
Right.
The IRS is never going to send an email to a senior asking for identifying information. But to check back through your office, to check back through the senior center mm-hmm. on any of those financial decisions, I think is incredibly important for our seniors, because it's their future at stake.
That's right. And, yeah. you know, like you say, there seems to be new scams out every other week.
I know, to report
these to their local officials, to the police, so they can be proactive in preventing some type of loss or whatever scam might be going on.
Right.
You know, I know an important bill right now that we're working on together is some additional funding for the Council on Aging. And working with you and the members yesterday with the caucus, I think we were able to gather a lot of support, which is hopeful as we navigate through the budget. And I know you're meeting with the speaker after this show, matter of fact,
yes.
to advocate for that.
So I'm being asked as the chairwoman to meet with the speaker, but it's your work that's organized those representatives. And it's another example of us working together. I know on that list of representatives you have, there are Democrats and there are Republicans, and there are people that are really conservative and people that are really liberal. And everybody's pulling for our seniors. And that money that would come back to our Councils on Aging in Quincy and in Randolph, in those areas, is money that is utilized by the Council on Aging, specific to the culture of that community. So how Quincy will use it is different than how Randolph will use it, but it will make a difference for those seniors. And most of that money, when we were able to do this once before, was used for outreach. So the issue you're talking around the senior circuit tax breaker, the issues that I'm talking about are around senior protective services, that's outreach. So our seniors need more information and all of that assistance to help them to be independent may not come from the state, but we can connect people to where those resources are with
yes.
good outreach.
Yeah. Well, you know, I one of the reasons I wanted to have this show with you is this is certainly a very important issue to my district, and to encourage the seniors who might be watching at home now, it's a great time to call. You know, if they have any concerns or they would like to talk a little bit more about how the budget is being spent, what is it being spent on, and what issues are important to them, you know, because mm-hmm. The governor, of course, we're reviewing his budget right now, but the House is preparing their budget, the Senate is preparing their budget. So collectively, you know, this is the right time to improve our laws and hopefully get as much money for our districts as we can in issues for seniors as possible.
And that kind of brings us full circle to our backgrounds, right? Because when we're talking about the budget, the issues that you know best around people with handicaps and people who have some kind of disabilities, right? Everyone says they care about those issues, but we have to fight a little bit harder to get money to those issues. So that you are thinking about those things and thinking about the seniors in the district is incredibly important. And it's going to be a struggle, you know. I can't tell myself how much resources we're going to have in this budget. So every dollar is going to be a fight, and I'm glad we're fighting for our seniors.
Well, it's great to work with you. You know, for the viewers at home, there are 160, of course, legislators in the House of Representatives, and the magic number has always been 81. we have to get 81 votes for a majority. Yeah. But you know, yesterday when you and I were collectively working at the senior caucus, it was very encouraging when we were soliciting members to get over. I think we're up to 110 members now.
That's great.
Who are supporting the increase in funding for our councils on aging. You know, and like you said, it's bipartisan support. It's great to work with the Republicans and the Democrats. It's not like Washington. You can actually, you know, roll up your sleeves. We have common goals and common interests. We might not always see eye to eye, but at least we're looking in the right direction.
That's right. You know, that's right.
And with Governor Baker now, I think he's shown his leadership with that bipartisan support, and it's certainly trickling down, I think, into the House and the Senate. You know, we all have common goals. We all want to make sure that we're improving the quality of lives of our seniors and giving them as much so they can stay and live independently.
And when you were talking about the seniors that you're talking to in your district that want to stay in their homes, it reminds me as a nurse what I'm saying to people. I think that is a great decision. You know, stay in the community that you know best and that knows you, with the market you shop at and the library you go to and the church that you may attend, because to stay physically and emotionally and healthy is the most important thing as we age. And I think it's the people around us that help us do that best.
Yeah. You know, when my father, Charlie, had passed away, my brother, Chuck, and I had assumed the caretaking responsibilities of my mom, Beverly, who had suffered from Alzheimer's. But, you know, we were able to keep her, we were fortunate, we were able to keep her right at home until she passed with some help, and our wives were very cooperative. But, you know, we managed. You do what you have to do. But she was in a loving environment, right at home, where she felt comfortable. So, you know, that those are some of the things that I look at. I know when we're debating, you know, for senior issues up on Beacon Hill at the State House. And, you know, it's great to work with you under your leadership. You. And I know I'm very hopeful we're going to have a successful budget with the speaker.
I hope so, too. I hope so, too.
Well, I think we're just about wrapping it up, but you know, I want to thank QATV for allowing us to film this show today. A special thank you to Chairwoman Denise Garlick, the Chairwoman of Elder Affairs, to talk about some of the senior issues. I certainly want to encourage any viewers to contact my office regarding senior issues or any other issue we're deliberating over at the State House. If you'd like to meet with me, I hold office hours every Friday morning by appointment. You can call 617-722-2230 to schedule a time. And thank you for tuning in.